Hello students, welcome to the second lecture of the series that we have on email etiquette. As we know about the email has become a significant choice for most users, as was also discussed and mentioned in the previous lecture. Today we are going to be looking at pitfalls and potential of email. Because of the apparent ease of sending an email message, computer systems are often flooded with an excessive amount of information. And this has led to several problems. While using an email effectively could actually lead to the maximum potential of the organization being put out for the best use of the organization's reputation, it becomes important for us to understand what could possibly go wrong with an email. In order to look and understand those pointers, let's look at the first point. Sometimes it could happen that your computer would not get connected to ISP service. But that would happen only if in case you use wrong username or password. So make sure you are checking them correctly, specifically when you know that your password may be case sensitive. The next point that we have could be that your email might have been returned. The email might bounce back to you and you will receive a mailer domain message, a failed mail message with a heading that says return mail user unknown. Most likely this mistake could be because of the address, which could be wrong. Alternatively, it could be because of the destination of computer or within the network that issue could be there. So in such cases, you could try resending the mail. The next point is when you clicked on send button, but you want the message to be stopped from being sent. If you're working offline, you can simply delete the message from your outbox. But if you're online, when you press the button send, then there is nothing you can do to stop it. Make sure you avoid such situations where you regret. The next point is when you receive a message about the virus warning, it could happen that a lot of messages like these might be circulated and you might have one in your inbox. These are called hoax messages, and you cannot get a virus by opening an email like that, but you can definitely get one by opening an attachment, which could also lead to serious damage. The next point that you have is receiving a message saying that you could win a big prize. Those messages are also hoax messages and you should not forward them to anyone else. Let's look at certain problems that we experience with email. The first is that you could actually find that instant messaging facility that is there in the email could actually lead to an interruption with little bell or a voice that says you've got an email. These interruptions can also interfere with your planned work or add frustration or stress to your workload. In some companies, staff has been given a responsibility that, or it is compulsory for them to have the alert on all the time on, because their boss insists on doing this so that nothing urgent is missed. But unless it is a specific requirement in your job, you must make sure that you switch off your email alert. This will help you focus on your work in a better way. The next thing is that it could lead to wastage of time. Composing and replying an email can also take up a lot of your time, and that time could actually be spent on your real job. So it's a common courtesy for us to reply to an email as soon as possible, even if in case it is just an acknowledgement saying that you will give the matter more attention and you will write back later. The next point is it's always best, not the best choice of medium. If you have to exchange an email message to resolve a situation or a problem, which could actually be safely and efficiently be done on a telephone or a face-to-face discussion, it is always better to choose the other medium, the latter medium. Before you send an email, make sure you ask yourself, is it really the best way to deliver a message? It may be convenient and quick, but will it be suitable as well? For example, if you have to pass a bad news or deal with an uncomfortable situation, it's best that you pick up the telephone. The next point is confidentiality can be a problem. If you want to keep something confidential, you have to remember that your employer has the right to read without your consent or knowledge any email that you send or receive at work. Therefore, make sure you are careful what you write. Then you might find that email is overload could be there. A lot of times we see that the managers are receiving hundreds of messages every day, which could actually lead to overload that could develop. Mostly these are forwarded messages, and sometimes these messages are not even really needed to be read by the individual. So this leads not only to annoyance but also to overloading of network. Please make sure you are not wasting your other people's time like that. Then the next point is overflowing inboxes. Email messages that are not deleted can cause not only a paper mountain but also an electronic mountain. You must make sure that you are constantly checking your mailbox and sometimes deleting those messages that are no longer needed. Increased stress levels. I must share this news with you that research shows that one of the top 10 causes of workplace stress is the pressure of keeping up with email messages. It's the highest ranked than having a bad relationship with your boss or dealing with a customer complaint. So let's make sure that the experience points the way to letting email work for you and not against you. Many people feel that because it's an email, it has to be acted on instantly, and hence more haste and less speed. This adds to the pressure that people are already facing and also leads to spelling, punctuation, grammar and structure mistakes. So what happens is in the rushed message that you have to type, you realize that your message is garbled with spelling, grammar and punctuation errors with a poor structure and no real focus. And because of that, you will be writing a trail mail further to clarify your message. The next point is junk email or spam. These are many a times emails sent for unsolicited advertising, and we have to know how do we deal with spam messages as well. Then the last point that we see is that it could lead to death of a conversation. People are supposed to be speaking to each other regularly, but nowadays they are communicating via email. So make sure you understand when is it that you are significantly to make an effort to talk to an individual. Do not avoid conversations. Make sure you understand the very value of it while you are to give it in writing, or when are you to make sure that you have to give a telephonic Let's look at 10 complaints about email in practice. When we talk about the complaints, the first point that is there is that it could have a vague subject line. People will sometimes not even read a message unless the subject line captures their attention in the first place. You know, there are people who are very busy, they get a lot of messages every day and they do not have time. Make sure you help your reader understand the bigger picture by composing a very clear subject line. And it should clearly state what the message is all about. It should be very brief as well. The next point is no greeting, no sign off. Nothing annoys the reader more than receiving a message from someone who does not begin with a simple greeting. You have to make sure that you end the mail with the name of the person or your name who is going to be sending the message. Please remember the simple courtesies of greeting and sign off. The next point is where you look at more people using the email, where you find the sloppy work is becoming more of a problem. And the common complaints include not being clear on the goal of the email, not attempting to develop a logical flow of ideas, not doing spell check, poor typing habits, trending email more like a quick chat rather than as a concise written document. The next point is that in the sloppy work, sometimes it could result to writers using all capitals or lowercase abbreviation. In the world of email, using capital letters is equivalent to shouting. This is seen as rude and annoying, and it should not be necessary for even for you to put up the subject line in capital letter. It could also lead to bad grammar, spelling and punctuation, and this would hamper your credibility as well. Your message gives an impression of your organization and of you as an individual. Make sure that the message that you type leads to a good impression, and you take much care while you are composing the email message, just like as you would while writing a formal letter. The next point is poor formatting. Some people just go on writing with no space or breaks between the paragraphs. Now, if you write long-winded sentences and no paragraphing, no blank lines between paragraphs, your message will not be easy to read, and that will not do good to your reputation as well. Then you have vague messages. The comment that you get in the survey mostly is that you receive messages which are very difficult to figure out. For instance, you do not understand what is the action that you are required, that is needed from the other persons at the receiving end. Email messages therefore are often sent in such a rush that the writer does not even plan the message beforehand, and hence there is no structure. You have to make sure that you do not write emails that would lead to frustration and confusion. Rather, plan your email, the language, and give it a structure. Unfriendly tone is the next complaint, where you find that it is very difficult in an email to be communicating your emotion because you do not have the tone of voice, you do not have gestures that are being used here. It could also lead to misunderstanding that could occur in an email. So while you are sending the email, make sure you are using the right tone and right word. The next point is CC the whole wide world. One of the common mistakes that they do is they send the copies of email messages just for the sake of it and forward these copies to people who really do not even need them. Think of it very, very carefully while you are copying the message. The next point is hunting for the response. When somebody sends you a message and you have to send a reply, make sure you are sending them your message at the top. Many a times it becomes very annoying if in case the reply being sent by the sender is towards the end. While you open the email, the first thing you see is your own message. So at the first thought, there is confusion and it hits you that sender's message may be somewhere else. So you go on hunting to look for the reply. Please don't waste people's time like this. Format your defaults so your messages are at the top when you click on reply. Let's now look at when we should not use email. First situation is when your messages are confidential. As we have discussed, that email messages can be read by other people and certainly by the system administrator. So there is also a problem that your recipient could easily forward your messages to someone else. Perhaps it could be done inappropriately as well. And this information that you want, if in case it is to be confidential, it's better that you use a letter and put it in an envelope marked as confidential. The next point is when messages are long and complicated. Email recipient wants to process messages quickly, and they usually read the messages on the screen. Long, complicated messages will not look good on the email. So if you have a very long message which must be included, you must make sure that you structure it in such a way that the reader can quickly focus and scan your essential details. Make it convenient for the reader. When there are many issues to be resolved or to clarify, you must avoid using email, because back and forth having a lot of questions to be answered in the situations of issue, it will lead to a lengthy email conversation, which can actually become very frustrating. So it's easier and it will save your time if in case you could use your telephone to ask questions and receive immediate replies. The next point is when messages are indiscreet. When you send an email message, ask yourself if you would want the message posted on the company's notice board. You know about it that email can easily be copied, printed or forwarded. Therefore, please do not use email to badmouth a colleague or employer, to conduct a romantic affair, to pass on a gossip or to discuss office politics. The potential for embarrassment is huge, and not to mention the possibility of finding yourself out of job. Do not write an email if in case you are angry. Your words can be read and reread over and over again by others, and this could be used against you as well. If you have something unpleasant to discuss, make sure you pick up the telephone and discuss it face to face. Never use email if in case you are angry. The next point that you have is when the message is emotive or sensitive. Well, we understand that with the written word, there is no body language, intonation or gestures, which will actually help you figuring out the meaning of the email. So therefore, it becomes easy for a person to misinterpret your mail, and it will be done quite innocently. So if in case you think that the topic that you are to write about is emotive or sensitive, it's best that you do not put it in writing. Let's look at why is it that we should and how is it that we should think twice before you hit the word send. Now, before sending out any message, make sure you are asking yourself questions like, is it easy to read? Is my meaning quite clear? Is the content hurtful or offensive? Is the tone appropriate? Is the message right for email? Would a letter or a phone call or a face-to-face discussion be better? While you are doing all of this, I'm also here to tell you that when is it in situations that you will have telephone or face-to-face communication as more appropriate means of communication. You could use them while you are to negotiate. You need an instant yes or no answer. You want to discuss a sensitive or intimate matter. You don't want to seem too intimidating. You want to retain confidentiality. In such cases, it's best to use telephone or face-to-face communication. Now, while we have discussed all these challenges and problems, let's look at how we can convert them into a potential. The first point here is remember that you're talking to a human being. While you're holding a conversation online, it's easy for your correspondent to misinterpret the meaning. And therefore, it's essential for us to understand that the real conversation, which requires facial expressions, gestures, and tone of voice, none of that is possible while you have written words. So whatever you have is written words, and it's best that you put yourself in another person's place and imagine how would you feel on receiving that message. Let's look at the second point, which is make your message clear and to the point. While you are to compose effective email message, make sure your messages are clear and logical. Long-winded words and long-winded sentences are not there to impress and will only lead to confusion. So make sure you are paying attention to the content of your writing as well as structure and flow of your message. Learn to love the written word, learn to play with the written word, learn to make the most of the written word, and avoid the capital case, just like you would avoid it in writing a traditional letter. The next point is make your message look good. Now, how long does it take for you to write the salutation, dear Mr. So-and-so, or finish off by writing your name? How long does it take to start a new paragraph every few lines? How long does it take for you to put a blank line between those paragraphs? Get into these good habits from now on. Looking good online goes hand in hand with sounding good, and these will give your reader a good impression of you. The next point is use the reply button. When you are responding to someone else's email, make sure you are not simply opening a brand new message to respond to them. People have dozens of email every day. It will help them if you click on reply button and write your text within the original message that will be included within the reply. And while you are replying, your message should be at the top, not at the bottom. The next point is respect your reader's time. We know about it that we have more work to do and less time to do it. The number of email messages that you have in the inbox will only lead to already whale workload. So show some respect to your reader by making sure that your message is very brief and concise. Include all the relevant detail and structure logically. Using an appropriate salutation and close is essential, and use a very clear and specific subject line. These are common principles that will help you maximize the great potential of email that you are to write. Make sure that you attend the third lecture of the series as well, which will help you understand the intricacies and some new things about writing email. Thank you.